Hey everybody, I'm Jessica Lee. I'm a professional jazz and blues singer and the host of Creative Space, where we shine a light on wonderful places and spaces that are bursting with creativity. Today we're at Dorothy 6 in Homestead, PA on 8th Avenue. Come on in. Dorothy 6 is a truly creative space. The architecture, the history, the food and drink are amazingly creative. And then we have all kinds of wonderful things happening here. Music, visual art being displayed. So we're really happy to welcome you to Dorothy 6 in Homestead, PA. I'm here today with Tom, and Tom's going to tell us all about who he is, his startup story, and how he came to create Dorothy 6. Dorothy 6, this is really Dorothy 6 Cafe, is that the formal name?
Well,
what's the formal name?
We did Dorothy 6 Cafe, but we actually just changed it to Dorothy 6 Restaurant.
Okay, so
because
Dorothy
we were
6
getting,
Restaurant.
People weren't thinking we were a restaurant, they were just thinking we were a cafe.
Okay, so, I know when you Google, you can find Dorothy 6 Cafe, but you're on 8th? Street?
Yes, this is on 8th Avenue.
8th Avenue, the main drag in
yes.
Homestead. So
yes.
Take us back to where you were before you decided to come to 8th Avenue in Homestead, PA. What were you doing? Why did you decide to take a look at this building?
Well, I grew up in Homestead. I went to school two blocks up the street. One of my first jobs was at a trucking company down here on 6th Avenue. So I was very familiar with the area.
Stop there. Tell us about Homestead when you were a kid and when you were growing up. And tell us about this street in particular, right? 8th Avenue was a main drag back
yes.
then. What was it like back then?
Back then, there were so many shops up and down the street. You can get anything you wanted here. Clothes stores, multiple shoe stores, cobblers, delis, restaurants. More bars than enough were in here.
You had some churches.
The churches. when the bell rang across the bridge there, an average 1,200 guys would walk across the street and everything would just get flooded. Around the bend, there was an old bar called Strucker's at one time. And he used to cash the checks for the mill guys that worked there.
Steel.
Well,
what type of workers were there?
They were steel workers.
They were all steel.
In the mill.
Okay.
Yeah, they were all in the mill. So on a Wednesday, he would have people lined up and outside the door just to cash their checks, and then they would get a beer and a fish sandwich or a roast beef.
Yeah.
It was this was a very quaint, busy town. And it was just not this town. It was all the towns all the way up and down the river. Hazelwood, Homestead, Braddock, McKeesport, Duquesne, they were all
hustling
and
bustling.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And that's how I remember Pittsburgh back in the day. Smoky city. It was always dirty. But I loved it growing up as a kid.
But people had careers.
Yes.
Not just jobs. They had
yeah.
careers.
Yes.
And they supported the communities by spending their money in the communities.
Right.
And you remember it as vibrant.
Yes.
Yeah. So about what year did that start to change?
That started changing around 1980, 81, 82. It's when all the mills are actually getting torn down.
Okay. So when did you start to think about this space and buying the building?
2008.
2008. So you're about 8 years after the waterfront is started up.
Yes.
You
yes.
come and you see this building.
The building looked really like a nice building. It came in, it had the chandelier, had some stained glass windows that were here. It was an old place that looked like it could just use, cleaned up, fixed up a little bit, and used.
Yeah, and what was it before you purchased?
It was a restaurant bar.
So you had a kitchen?
Yeah, it was a partial kitchen.
Okay.
Went downstairs and there was 4 inches of standing water. At the time, the county owned the building. And there was a credit union around here had a little involvement in it, so they had a little lien against it.
Okay.
So I made a deal with both of them to buy the building very cheap. Then I started here, and the first thing was do was put a French drain around the inside, get all the water out, and dry the building up. I did that. 6 months later, I was here working one night, and I could still smell mold. So I come downstairs, and I kicked the drywall around the doorway there, and behind it was plaster. And I guess the old owners, what they did is they just put drywall up to cover everything up.
Oh.
So that wall over there was leaking in water pretty bad, and that's where the water in the basement was coming from. So at that point, I decided, well, it's time to tear everything apart.
Okay.
And I tore everything apart down to the brick walls and started over.
Okay. So you didn't tear the walls down. You could see the brick walls on the sides here and here.
Yeah. But
so you took everything down to the brick inside.
Right. Well, this brick wall here, there was multiple holes through it from other people doing different things. The brick was in real bad shape. We probably put 1,000 brick in this side, and then this side was all repointed. That side was a pretty good wall, so just needed a lot of cleanup work.
Okay.
But it took me about 11 months just to do the walls in here. And then after that, I started on the building.
Okay. So how many years did you take to renovate the building?
It was a 3.5-year project.
3.5 years to renovate. And how old is the building? Do you know about?
It's early of 1900s. I do not have a correct date, but it was probably from around some of these other buildings. I'd say 1905 to 1912.
Wow. They don't make them like they used to, right?
No.
The high ceilings in here.
Yes.
And
the tin ceiling upstairs is still original.
Okay.
The birch floors are original floors in here.
Yeah, that's cool. This space has a lot of history to it.
Yes.
So, okay, when the building was done, you've renovated it.
Mm-hmm.
When did you open it up as a restaurant?
We opened it up in 2014.
Okay.
In the middle of October.
Okay, October is your birthday.
Right, so it's coming up on our 5-year anniversary.
You'll be 5 years old. Okay, so now you have to build a staff. Mm-hmm. You have to find a chef. You have to decide about the menu, food and drink. Tell us about that, because I will say, I have sung here one time so far, loved it. I'm getting ready to sing here again, and we'll talk about that a little later. I can't wait. The food was fantastic. People who came for the first time were raving about your food, not just saying it's good or it's great. They're like, this is some of the best food I've had in the whole region. Your drink selection, your beers, pretty cool. How did you start to think about staffing up and getting to that point?
Staffing is still a hard part. I'm still staffing.
It's a challenge.
It is
to
very,
get great
very,
people.
Yes.
Yeah.
I went through a lot of interviews with a bunch of different cooks.
Okay.
And Matt Davis, that I have now, has been here for 5 years.
Matt Davis is your
He's
chef.
My chef, and he is part of the food. If it wasn't for Matt, none of the food would be in this place.
Yeah, and where did you get him from? Did you recruit him away from somewhere?
We
was he
met,
looking?
We met. He was working at another restaurant.
Okay.
We met. He had to give a couple-week notice at his other restaurant. And he said he'd give me a try and see what happened. 5 years later, we're still arguing and yelling at each other, but it's a good relationship.
Tell everybody out there in TV land your full name.
My name is Matthew Davis.
Matthew Davis. And Matt, how you came to meet this gentleman here, Tom? Where were you coming from? What's your background? How did you kind of get into the culinary world?
Well, I actually started cooking when I was 17 years old in high school. I was used to work with the Juno's Dingbats Company.
Yeah.
Back in the late 80s.
Yeah.
So going back and forth to college and working in the culinary field is how I actually got my experience.
Where are you from?
I actually grew up in Beltsuver.
Okay. So you have that experience. You're working since mm-hmm. you're baby little kid.
Actually, it was more like play than actually work. I didn't, I'm in a kitchen. I'm 17 years old. I'm running around. I'm grabbing stuff. And as I'm actually cooking, the older guys are, and it's not really teaching. You actually have to, actively learn.
Yeah.
So, there's a lot of looking over people's shoulders because I'm culinary trained, but I did not go to culinary school.
Yeah, but you know, just like law school and medical school, those are relatively new. It was used to be that you were an apprentice.
Exactly.
Right? You had a mentor.
Right.
So who are some of your mentors? Do you have one in particular who
I've
you
actually,
loved?
I've actually worked with a lot of great chefs.
Yeah.
My one good friend, Mike Simpson, works over at the Sausalitos in Bloomfield.
Okay.
He's actually an Olympian, culinary Olympian.
Wow, what does that
mean?
So
he actually was on the culinary Olympic team. He's a CIA grad.
Wow.
He's one of my good friends. If I ever need to call him, call on him. On Callaway, he works down at the meatball factory. I forget the name, but he actually, if I need to call on him, I mean, there's a lot of good. Glenn Taylor, when I first started working the Juno's company, I was almost like his pet project. Every time he had a party to do, he would actually come to the restaurant and get me, and I would actually go out to his house and do the prep work at his house.
So you had tremendous mentors.
That's had a lot of mentors. Awesome. I had a lot of gifts.
Yes, a lot of blessings there. So how did this gentleman walk into your life?
A friend of a friend. Friend of a friend introduced us. We argued for a little bit, talked about some food, and here we are 4.5 years later.
So he kind of recruited you away, another position a little bit, talked you into coming over for the startup. You were here from the very beginning.
From the very beginning.
Okay. You've mentioned friendly arguments.
Yes, they're friendly.
From time to time.
As brothers fight, we fight like brothers.
Right. So you're able to disagree.
And move on.
And our entire world needs to learn from the two of you. Right? Our entire world needs to learn how to disagree agreeably. And sometimes not agreeably, but move on and not let it impact the quality of your relationship.
One of my favorite quotes, and I say it often here, is from Forrest Gump. And it's when he says, "All right, how about I lay my back up against your back? And this way, our heads won't be in the mud. So, brother, if I support you as you're supporting me, this way, our heads won't be in the mud." And that's what keeps this place going.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
He's told me that so many times, it's unreal.
Yeah. So I have had the pleasure of singing some jazz and blues here upstairs one time. I'm coming back soon. I had the crab cakes. That was a divine experience. I mean, they were the best crab cakes I've ever had.
They're actually a gluten-free crab cake. I make a shrimp mousse first.
Okay.
And then I incorporate the crab inside the crab cakes, so there's not actually any fillers. It's just all meat.
I will tell you, the one thing that I heard again and again from people who were first-timers when I came to sing, they were blown away with the amazing quality of the food. They were blown away. They were raving about it. So talk about what are the things that you have fought through. What, you know, you guys were creating a menu together, right? What were some of the inspirations for the menu?
Well, he basically let me do what I wanted.
Okay.
Besides the pierogies, his sister actually makes the pierogies from scratch.
Yeah.
And the chicken paprikash. Well, his sisters actually showed me how to make the Hungarian dishes. So, it's not really, it's more of the operation of a restaurant. I mean, he is a business owner and he's owned a business a lot longer than I've actually ran a restaurant, but I need to show him actually how to run a restaurant.
Right, okay. So you really weren't micromanaged, Tom. You didn't really get in the way of the creativity for the menu and all of that.
I mean, he eats what I cook. So if it doesn't pan out, then it's not going on the menu.
All right, then he's going to tell you about it.
So he does eat what I cook. And
so do you know what his favorite dish is?
He's all over the place. It depends. Sometimes he'll go out and he'll have something and I'll recreate it here.
Okay.
That's another one of my gifts if I can see something, or even if you describe it to me very well, I can basically recreate it.
Wow. Yeah. So when you're talking to people today, like we're just hanging out speaking within Dorothy Six, but there's a television audience who's going to hear about Dorothy Six for the first time. Come on over to 8th Avenue, the main drag of Homestead, right? It's safe. It's becoming more vibrant.
Mm-hmm.
What are the things that you would say, hey, there's some unique things to taste here that you might not find everywhere else around the region? Talk about just a couple of the things. I mean, I think the crab cakes are worth driving a couple hours for. But What else?
The one thing I'm really proud of is all of our steaks are cut to order.
Okay.
We have 8-ounce, 12-ounce, and a 16-ounce steak actually on the menu. Okay. But you can get them as big as you actually want. So all of our steaks are actually cut to order, and that's a product of my freshness. The type of food I'd like to describe my food as upscale comfort food. I mean, with the decor here and everything, it's almost a homely type feeling. So you want to feel like home when you actually come to the Dorothy Six.
Yeah.
You can get some couches upstairs so you can take a nap afterwards.
Yeah, exactly.
But that's what I try to make. I want people, when they eat my food, I want them to be reminded of the food that they used to eat when they were growing up.
Yeah.
But a little bit better.
I have a brother-in-law who works at American Textile up the road.
Okay.
And they come here for lunch and things like that and rave about the food.
Thank you.
So, I mean, the word is starting to get out. Right. I mentioned that to my family that I'm coming here and singing, oh, we love the food there. I take my team to Dorothy Six all the time, you know, for lunch. Mm-hmm. So your favorite thing about working here, being part of the team, helping Dorothy Six develop, your favorite thing?
Let me start with the first time I actually met Tom.
Yeah.
And I saw the space, and this is what actually caught my attention, that he actually had the railroad wrapped around the bar, the railroad tracks actually wrapped around the bar, and they're actually
these
parallel.
These are railroad tracks.
Yes, and
right
they're the exact width that a railroad track should actually be. And if you're going to take this much care and put into this building, that's like, this place is beautiful. And you got to realize it was all covered up, and I'm like, this is just a beautiful space. And with that, I was like, well, how about I write you a menu and we'll just go from there. And I told him I can make anything from fish sticks to foie gras. So I tried to kind of find something in the middle that would actually sell in this area. I mean, we've been through, our menu changes seasonally.
Okay.
So, I mean, we keep our favorites on, but there's always something new and exciting on our menus each season.
So it's almost like one of your favorite things was the creativity. I mean,
exactly.
You saw this as a piece of art.
Exactly. I mean, this whole place is a piece of art.
Yeah.
And you got to realize most of the stuff he actually did with his hands, like all the welds he actually did. It's crazy.
There's a lot of love in that.
Right.
How did you come to the current menu? Was that collaborative? Was that mostly?
I let Matt run with it. I tell him what I like, things that I would like to have on the menu, and I let him run with it.
Okay.
It's his deal in the kitchen. The crab cakes are fantabulous.
Best crab cakes I think I've ever had. And I've been all over the country and all over. They are the best crab cakes.
Yes, they are.
I've ever had. Yes. I was blown away. So crab cakes, there's no filler.
No, he does not.
It's all crab.
No filler.
It's crazy.
We do stuffed salmon with crab. Very, very good. The steaks are hand-carved, so we can cut you a steak from an 8-ounce to a 36-ounce if you like it. The pierogies, my family does. My two sisters,
wow. They
make our pierogies here.
They're homemade.
Yes. She's been doing it for about 30, 40 years now, and she does. That's our pierogies.
Do the homemade pierogies only for Dorothy Six here?
Only for Dorothy Six.
They don't sell them outside,
no.
So you can only get their homemade pierogies
only
here.
Only from here.
Oh,
yes.
I love it. I'm part Slovak, part Italian. I appreciate the pierogies.
And we've had people coming in here and want to buy multiple dozens of pierogies, and I just can't do that because they're doing it as a favor for me, and not only that, it's a piece of love that's coming out of the restaurant.
Go to the drink for a second. I want the guys to get a shot at some point of the wonderful beers that you have listed here.
My manager, Pat Hayes, he likes his beer, and I have to give him credit for doing a good beer list. And it's a changing. We pretty much rotate all the beers all the time. There's two on there. It is permanently. It is our 5 and 10. And then we do a mixture of those two for our number 21, and we call it the Homestead 5 and Die.
Okay, so 5 is McKenzie's Hard Cherry Cider?
Yes.
And 10 is the All-Tech Kentucky Bourbon Stout.
Right.
And you mix those to create the Homestead 5 and Die.
Yes.
And you have 21 available all the time. Is that for Roberto Clemente?
No, I never thought about that. But that's a good one.
Yeah. Another thing I just want to touch on is the art. We're going to see some of your art in here. When we talk about creative spaces, you have all kinds of events here, live music, all different kinds of live music. You have wonderful visual art as well hanging in the space, throughout the space. Has that been a love of yours for a while?
I've always liked art. I cannot perform art like some people. This is my art here. I built the bar. I built this place out. This is my...
With your own two hands, you built the bar.
Yes, that's this amazing. Is a light gauge train reel. These here are metal cutouts that we did with a water jet, and they are all the different mills that my ancestors worked for.
Wow,
so I kind of gave up the bar to all my aunts and uncles that worked in the mill.
That is cool. People have to come just to see the bar who have family members who used to work in steel.
When I was building the place out, I wasn't for sure on a name. I had it in my head. I wanted to call it OH5 in Homestead, which was the open hearth in Homestead. Okay. They had 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 furnaces. And when the mill moved the furnaces up the river, they named them after, from what I was told, the boss's wives, because they were never at home.
Aww.
So that's how Dorothy came up, and Carrie across the street. And somebody brought the name Dorothy Six. And I'm laying in bed one night, and my brother passed away probably about 10 years ago. We ran a body shop together. Prior to that, he was one of the guys that climbed to the top of Dorothy Six and cut it down.
Wow.
So I'm like, all right, David cut it down. I'm going to put it up. And the next thing came to my head was, if we can't pour steel, we're going to pour beer.
Yeah.
And that's how...
That gave me chills about your
this
brother.
All yeah. Comes up.
That's awesome.
Yeah. The visual art, I have two artists, Rick Bach, very good friend, and Bill Miller, another really good friend. I met them, known Rick for a while, and I met Billy after I opened this place up.
Okay.
I just want to tell you a little bit about our artwork. To my right here is Rick Box. Some of these paintings were here when I bought the building. I was actually going to throw them away. He took them and painted over them and gave them back. So you can still see a little bit of the original painting behind it. And he has a lot of other original stuffs upstairs. And to my left here is a gentleman by the name of Bill Miller. He's also a friend of Rick Box. They both went to school back in the day together at Pittsburgh Art Institute. And he does all his art with mosaic, ripped up floor tile. And this is the Titanic over here behind me. And we have some other ones I'd like to show you. The portrait next to me is Abe Lincoln. And that is also done by Bill Miller. And it's all done with the ripped up mosaic floor tile. And you can see how detailed his face is. And it's all stuff that people walked on. We're upstairs at the Dorothy Six. To the left of me, we have some metal artwork that's done by Rick Bach, and he calls these his bobbleheads. You can see they move. If they were outside and it was really windy, they would move around. And I would just like to say that mostly all the artwork that's in the building upstairs is all for sale. So if anybody would like to purchase anything, they can get in touch with me and I'll get in touch with the artist and they can work something out.
We want to look right here at this very special piece that is part of Pittsburgh's history. This was given to Tom at Dorothy Six as a gift, and I'm going to hand him the mic and let him tell you about this piece.
This piece is a gentleman that is rolling a piece of casting. It's probably 2,400 degrees plus, and so it's a very, very hot relationship he's got with that piece he's making.
Tell people it's steel, right?
It's steel, yes. Yes, it's steel. It's a steel casting, which is red hot, and it's in a roller, and he's rolling it out.
And who gave it to you?
Actually, a friend of my sister's, and I believe that is her uncle.
The pieces that you have throughout the place, you built the bar yourself.
Right.
I'm thinking you found some of the other pieces that are throughout the restrooms and the restaurant. Yeah.
I come across, like, actually the mirror that is in the ladies' room, that was a mirror that was in this place.
Okay.
So I just kind of repurposed it. There were some unique things in here that I saved. The chandeliers, they were all in here.
Yeah.
The floor's original tin ceiling, but pretty much everything else had to get gutted because of the mold.
Okay.
And then I like art. I just come across crazy things. And there's been a lot of good people that come and visit here on a regular basis. And they brought a lot of these unique pieces to me. So some of these things you couldn't even buy.
Yeah.
And I'm so gracious for people bringing them here. Some of them are only on loan, and some of them are here permanently.
That's wonderful. So the community is infused into your creative space.
Yes.
People bring things for you to display and
use. Yes, to show it off, to show, like, this was a mill town at one time, and that's what it, that's what we want it to be still.
Yeah. So your patio, just tell us about how you had the idea to create this gorgeous patio. And is there something out there, a piece of artwork out in your patio?
There is a monument when you walk in the front door of the patio. There is a handstone carving piece. It came off of a building down on Forbes Avenue probably 40 years ago. And it was getting stored over in Southside. A friend of mine found them, a couple other pieces, got in touch with the person that owned it, bought them, had them transferred to his place. He had to use a low boy and a backhoe to move them because they're so heavy. And 6 years ago, when I was just getting this place ready to open up, he decided that he didn't want them no more and they were moving away. So I have a stone carving out there. It's got to be over 100 years old.
Wow.
And it's just, it's a beautiful piece.
From Forbes Avenue.
Yeah, and it weighs 2,500 pounds.
Wow.
So it's stuff like that, it's really unique.
Your patio, did you create that initially, or did you create that after you had the whole building up and running?
There was like a deck out there.
Okay.
And it was in bad shape, and there was trees, and it was pretty much a junkyard out there.
Yeah.
So I had to start all over. So the deck they had out there was pretty good, but there was an open space underneath the deck. And food would probably fall down between the cracks, and what are you going to have underneath of that? So I'm like, I do not want that. Mm-hmm. So I decided that all the plaster and the brick that I took out of here, instead of hauling it away, I used it for fill out there.
Cool.
And then I just brought in a little couple truckloads of stone that I needed and leveled it out.
Wow.
And then we poured a patio.
Wow, you did that all yourself.
I did it with me and a couple guys, and then we hired concrete finish guys.
Well, you are an artist. I don't know if you consider yourself one, but you are an artist. I mean, that is fantastic. The whole space is fantastic. I can't believe you built that bar. That's just unbelievable to me.
We do from jazz to bluegrass to rock to pretty much anything. I like local artists. If any local artists out there would like to come play here, I would love that to happen. This space up here we use for when the weather outside will not cooperate with us, and then when the weather does cooperate, we'll have you out on the patio. This is some other Rick Box paintings here.
Beautiful. And Mad Max mentioned some of the...
Yes, he does a lot for Mad Max, Kaya, pretty much a big burrito company. So,
Live music coming.
Yes, live music coming to Dorothy 6.
Hey, everybody. Thank you for being with us today at Dorothy 6 and for watching Creative Space. I'm going to be singing here in August 3rd, with guitar great Mark Strickland. We're right here. Come on by anytime for terrific food, drink, live music. See the visual art. They turn 5 years old in October. Thank you for being with us on Creative Space.